Are you asking us questions or what?
Oh, no. They're going to be asking the questions.
But so who's going to direct this thing?
We
are.
Looking,
it looks like.
At me.
Okay.
Well, then, okay, I can kind of do whatever.
Yes, just get them.
We've just been taking questions. They'll shout them out. And
yeah, well, we'll see if they shout them out. Usually they all go quiet on us, don't they, Valerie?
Okay.
Okay, go.
First question.
See?
Who's got a question for Ms. Perrine and Ms. Douglas? This young man right here.
We both saw it on Friday night.
What did you think of it?
It's a different movie. It's a completely different movie to our Superman. I have to be honest in that I enjoyed the first half, and I didn't particularly enjoy the second half. I felt like I was in a video game, and I'm of the generation where I don't want wham, 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 wham. It was all a bit too much. And I really loved Henry. I thought he was the hottest thing since sliced bread. Thank you very much. However, Christopher Reeve is still my Superman. That's all. Valerie, want to answer that?
I hated it.
Yep.
I hated everything about it. First, I fell asleep. And then all I saw were special effects and smashing into buildings and there was no story going on. There was no sympathy between characters. There was no character buildup. It was just special effects and slam bam, thank you, ma'am. Mm.
Yeah, I have to say that I really missed the humor, and I do think our movies had a lot of humor. But it also, Superman was it was all about truth, justice, and the American way. This new movie, I know the kids love it, and a lot of people enjoyed it. It's a different generation. And consequently, I mean, and also the other thing is there's no relationship between Lois Lane and Clark. I missed all of that, and Clark Kent.
No.
I wanted that discovery. So to me, I of course went to see it because all of you are saying, have you seen it? No, good. So we went off, didn't we, Valerie?
Yeah.
Valerie actually snored in the movie. Which was interesting. It was different, but I didn't loathe it. I enjoyed the first part. I honestly thought it went on 20 minutes too long. It was just a wee bit too long for me. But hey, the kids love it. But that's all I have to say on the subject. Okay, there you go.
Who else? Hmm? It's Clark Kent.
Hmm. That's a good question. Thank you. It's an original question. The day that I went to the screening with the crew and we saw that Superman could fly, because up until that moment, I think it was such a long business, wasn't it? Such a long, drawn-out process. And of course, back then, as you know, nowadays everything's done with everything's technical. But then it really was. There were many, many days where we didn't get a shot in, or there were problems. For instance, at the very beginning, Christopher, Superman doesn't sweat, but Christopher Reeve did perspire. And so when he first put his arms up, he perspired. So they had to figure out, and it took them a little while, to figure out how Superman shouldn't perspire. I know you're going to tell a story. You can tell it to me. But so there were lots of issues like that. And it was days, I mean, it was months and months and months. And the day we went to the, thank you, the day we went to the screening, and actually saw that Superman could fly, and that we all, the crew and the cast, we all believed it. That was when. But we knew that Madam here was hot, because God knows she was hot, but I was oblivious to the impact of Ursa. I was totally oblivious. It was a job. I went in, I had long hair, I put it in a wig, I put my costume on, they put white makeup on, they stuck my eyebrows up, covered my freckles, and I went to work. And then at nighttime, I went back to my husband, and you know, that was it. I had no idea of the impact. Valerie is building up for a story I can tell, so I'm gonna hand you over. Here you go, Adam.
We told a lot of stories last night.
Oh, we did.
Really got to know each other and become best friends.
Yes, it was really great. It was great. Finally, yeah. It's taken us 30 years because we never have time together, but we have had a blast here in San Antonio, so thank you.
Well, I had a problem that I see there's young people here. I'll try to put it in a way that you older people will understand. When I go to save Superman, I have to jump into the water and pull the kryptonite off of him. Well, I had on a white jersey dress, and we had something wrong showing
twice
after I got wet. Del Comics wouldn't allow it, and we spent all kinds of days figuring out what to do with the dress. And finally, we decided I wore 4 or 5 bras, and that took care of the problem.
Okay. Now we're on the subject of that part of the anatomy. As we discussed last night, my problem on the back lot at when I went to throw the bus across the street, it was about 4 a.m. and it was really, really cold. It was London. And there was an underground lake, which we didn't know until we started shooting, so the ground was icy, icy, icy. My problem was that Ursa, because of that fabulous costume with the slits up the side, there was nowhere to wear anything underneath. So I was completely, totally, utterly naked underneath, except I was able to wear a flesh-colored brassiere bra, which was my only warmth. So the only thing they could do for me on the back lot was to give me a mink-lined bra. So I actually had a pretty hot pair, if you don't mind me saying, Miss Perrine. Not quite as hot as yours, but I bow to your seniority and your Hollywood glamorism. Your breasts definitely win here. Okay, thank you.
All right, guys, who's next? Who's got something?
Who can follow that, huh?
Shoot.
Well, the very first time I didn't do a screen test. I just met with the directors. I was filming at something else. I wasn't able to test. But as they got more and more interested in me, the very first time that I put on a harness was the directors needed to know that I was able to go up at a great height and not lose the plot, because it seemed other actresses were coming along and auditioning very well, and then they would get in on the wires and they would say, which is all they said, you know, there was no training. Christopher had bodybuilding and stuff. You know, we arrived on the first day and they said, jump off that windowsill and, you know, fly to the other end of the studio. So the very first time, the harness was not the original flying harnesses that everybody wore were full body. For Peter Pan, for instance, were full body. But of course, they had designed the costume. Oh, I'm so glad Feora's finally looked up. You've been texting the whole time, honey. Don't think I haven't noticed you. That's okay. That's all right, but don't think I haven't noticed. Okay. Yeah, really. You're really busted, honey. But anyway, with that costume again, along with not being able to wear anything underneath, there was nowhere for a harness. There was no way, so I literally had a little garter belt with two rings on either side. So all of the support for my back had to be me. So, you know, you would hang over when you were relaxing, but then, you know, to actually fly and to hold what's called the kipper position was arching your back. So it was very uncomfortable. It was a lot more uncomfortable for Jack O'Halloran, who was quite well endowed. and Terrence Stamp, and they had a lot of squeezing, I'm told, that went on. Because I'm honest, you know, it's all around there squeezing. Woo! So it was not comfortable, but I loved it. I loved the whole sensation of flying. Did you fly? Oh, there we go.
I flew, and one of my wires broke, and I never flew again.
You know what they don't talk about? And again, talking about the film the other night, you know, we really flew. I mean, if you know what I mean, we really did the whole flying business and the landing, and with Man of Steel, you know, they've gone in a second, and it's, you know, you don't really get a great sense of what we went through. And there were horrible accidents, wires breaking. I had 9 separate injuries to my back over a period of the months because, you know, you're doing this film. It was an enormous film at the time, and I don't know that people really appreciate what an enormous film it was, but back then it was giant, absolutely giant. And you're on the set and you start having a little bitch and a complain. They don't, I mean, I have to about, you know, obviously Miss Perrine has come from Hollywood, and you got to really, I'm sure, have a lot more clout. I was a little English actress, and I was completely intimidated at the beginning. By the end of it, I wasn't, but at the beginning. You know, working with Marlon Brando, you know, Gene Hackman and all of these people, and indeed, although we didn't have any scenes together, I mean, Valerie was there, so I didn't say boo to anything. So when my back hurt, and when I had injuries, and when I tore my back throwing the bus across, I mean, to this day, I have treatment for my back, which where I tore the shoulder blade, and they will always say, well, how did you do that? And I said, well, it was when I was throwing the bus across the street. Because, you know, for the split second, the bus was on a chain, and the chain is on a crane, and you lift up the bus, and the bus moved a fraction. And for a split second, I had superpowers. So instead of relaxing my arms, I held it, and that's all it took. And it tore all my back. And instead of stopping, and in America, we definitely, with the unions here, we wouldn't have had any of that. And we just kept going then, didn't we? Just kept going, going, and going. Jack had injuries. I don't know, Terrence did. I mean, we had horrible things happen on the wires. And I didn't know that your wire snapped. But there were some very scary times. And there was also, we went back to shooting, as I'm sure you all know. We did 8 or 9 months, then there was a break, and we came back to it. And when we came back, the man that was in charge of the harnesses had left because he hadn't been paid. And so our harnesses that we'd had made specially to fit weren't there. So in my particular instance, on the first day, they put me in a man's harness, which we didn't know, and it was too loose. So they tightened and tightened and tightened, and I went up on the wires, and I started to go into the flying position, and they'd done it too tight, and I fainted, and I passed out, and I ripped all my stomach muscles, because of course you're up in the air. This was nowadays, it's I just don't think any of this would happen. And also the other thing is, and then I'll shut up, the three of us, the first time the three villains flew, and they had done the tracks in the sky, and God knows why, nobody had figured out that when you go round a corner, when you sway out, the momentum will swing you all out. And we all swung out, and we all got tied up like a bunch of conkers. I don't know if you have conkers. But and there we hung for a while. So yes, you know, lots and lots of problems with flying, but great fun. There you go.
I saw your hand go up first. You, yeah. Yeah.
Yes, that's exactly. Oh, yes, that's exactly it. Well, I wasn't on 2 wires. I wasn't on 1 wire. I wasn't doing wires. Because unlike Sarah here, I kind of said I'm not flying anymore.
Sure. There you
and
go.
That was it. I was too scared. I was really petrified of flying. By the way, the shakes are natural. I have what?
Essential tremors.
Essential tremors, what?
Catherine
Hepburn has. So I'm not, you're
so
not
So she's not being hitting
nervous.
The bottle or anything,
no,
any
no.
of you?
I don't have delirium tremors. I am just, this is
shaky.
It knew me.
All right, who, your hand's already up.
No idea there were two versions until long after they'd both been out, but I was already on to my next project.
And my reaction was, maybe finally I'm going to make some money and make some residuals, because I didn't make a penny out of Superman, but because I had very clearly in my contract that it should not be, that there couldn't be another movie. And as Warner Brothers promoted it as a different movie and another movie, we actually thought we had possibly a good cause to get a little bit of residual there, but nothing. But having said that, that aside, I just saw it about 3 weeks ago on the big screen with Terrence Stamp, and he hadn't seen it either. And it was like seeing, I kind of looked at it a few years ago when it first came out, but to be absolutely honest, I don't. If I catch Superman on television, I always stop and watch, because it's like, you know, it's not me, it's just fun to watch. But in this particular instance, to watch it again, I've forgotten how good it was and the difference in the story and the humor in it. I'm just sorry that there was all that incident with Richard, and I had no idea that he had that much footage, Valerie, to make another movie. Mm-mm. My goodness me. But I think it's a very sensitive. If you speak to Margot or any of the other cast, they're very, very sensitive about him, because they were big Richard Donner fans and they felt that he was really badly treated. So I'm glad he got his version out, you know. Thanks for the question.
That young fellow right there. Yeah, you.
Well, it wasn't Gene Hackman, because by then we had gone back to reshoot and they couldn't afford to bring Gene Hackman back. So it was another guy, a stuntman, which is why he has his head turned from camera all the time. The mold, the small mold that was an eyeliner body mold, and then there's a tiny mold above my back that the stunt actor, or the Gene Hackman, lay in, that started to bend into my lower spine. And as it was a computerized, that pole arm is computerized, as the system, as it started to go, I said, it's beginning to press down. But my point again, they just kept going. So I ended up vomiting out the side there. So I have my head away from camera. The actor, you'll notice if you look again, he has his head away, because it wasn't Gene Hackman. And I don't know what the answer is to your question, but I remember it very well. And that was another thing that, you know, they took terrific advantage of all of us. You know, I mean, Valerie very sensibly said no more. And I have to say, the only thing I said no more to was being shot in the face. Because when we did the White House sequence, when I come through the ceiling, you know, and they said, we want to see the guns leveled up, pointing at you, and we want to see splay coming out and you not reacting. And I remember saying, excuse me, if you see splay, you know, I'm not stupid. I said, is splay, doesn't that mean there's something coming out? I mean, isn't there something? Could I possibly? No. He said, you know, stop making, I remember it very clearly, stop making a fuss. And at the time I was married and my husband said, don't you do. I said, well, you know, they've said it'll be all right. So the day came round and it was a lot of teeter boards, a lot of stuntmen waiting. So when the sequence starts in the White House, I'm tossing guys over my shoulder. At the point where they brought the gun up and fire it at me, I got a load of shot. And it wasn't shot, but what it was there wasn't an armorer on the set. He'd also been let go. So they laid the gun down and it got dust in it. Luckily it was only dust, but it was enough to, so it got my face. And I, as it happened, obviously I felt it, I was like that. And they said, no, reset. And there were stuntmen falling everywhere and chaos everywhere. They said, reset, let's go again. And as they went again, they brought the gun up. And I freaked on that. And I said, I can't do it. And to this day, of course, you know, there's been lots of times that they've said, we're going to have a gun. And they say, not pointing at me, you're not. It's incredible. I mean, the risks and the things that they did back then. And again, The union here, our union is very, very good. In England, we were all saying, aren't we lucky to have this American movie over here? We're all making money, isn't it great? So just, I mean, my agents were as much to blame. They would just say to me, shut up. And my ex-husband, of course, that night, you know, the whole face, they've got little pop marks in. There are terrific risks all the time. But of course, the movie looks great, you know. What the hell's that? Ballistic glass or something? No.
Not on that production.
No. You know, we're talking about some producers here that that cut a lot of corners. I think it's fair to say the Sorkins. There's quite a few stories about them, and they cut some serious corners. And there were some serious injuries. I mean, I believe I'm right in saying that somebody lost their life when the mock-up plane fell and hit them right at the beginning of filming. I might be, but I think I'm right on that. No, they took terrific risks. And again, you know, I was 27, 28, and it was, although I'd been working a lot in England, you know, I was very well aware of the fact that I was the only English actress in it, and everybody was telling me that this was an enormous, you know, this was a fantastic opportunity. And the last thing, you know, we're all too damn polite. The last thing we would do is rock the boat. Now I'm a tough old bitch, but, you know, back then I was that, okay. I should have learned from Miss Perrine here.
All right, who's got something for me? What, you, sir?
Yes. Conan was, working with Schwarzenegger was an absolute blast. He was not yet married, he was engaged. So in the week, he was ours, and on the weekends, Marie would arrive and he would behave himself. But during the week, he really enjoyed, we all had a terrific time. Grace Jones is a very, very long time close friend of mine. And we, the two of us on the set in Mexico, just, we had a great time. And a lot of the crew had come from Superman. Mind you, everybody worked on Superman. So, you know, immediately after that, you were always working. And I loved, Arnold was really a lot of fun. He has a team of guys around him that he's worked with all his life, that started off as bodybuilders and now work for him and with him. So it's always him and the guys and the cigars and the women and the song and the dance and everything else. It was great. I loved it. I loved doing Conan. But I was also shooting in LA at the time, a TV series. So I used to have to fly down every week. I'd do 3 days in Burbank and then fly down to Mexico. So it was a tough schedule, but it was in the days when I didn't seem to need quite so much sleep. Funny that. It was great fun. Thanks for the question.
Okay, guys, what's next? Anybody? This gentleman right here. Yeah, with a child in his lap.
Yep. Valerie? Oh. You have to say something, otherwise I'm just talking. Okay.
I had no idea, I didn't know anything about Superman, I mean, other than I knew who Superman was. I had no idea until I started living in America in 82 of the impact of Superman, and that's why, in a way, when I was at the movies on Friday night, I kind of got into that whole truth, justice, and the American way type Superman. And the gentleness of our Superman to this new type of Superman, who I think was fantastic. But the actual movie to me rather summed up life today, and I thought it's just a little bit too scary for me. I don't like what I see, and I certainly don't like all those buildings falling down on top of my head. Too scary, but brilliant, you know, wonderful. I'm sure everybody will rush out and go again and make them lots of money, but I'll stick with the old-fashioned Superman, thank you very much. Plus, you know what? I didn't want to go to bed with Christopher Reeve or Superman, but this Henry, oh my Lord. He's hot, isn't he?
Yes.
That was the only time she woke up, she went, oh my God. When he came out, yeah, he's okay by us.
He's okay by us.
Next question. You, sir.
I didn't hear him.
Here's the question. Both of you got to work with Gene Hackman, Terrence Stamp. Any interesting stories about working with either person?
No, nothing naughty. I think it was Christopher's birthday. Somebody on the, one of the actors had a birthday, and Gene, you know, he had that thing on that made him look bald,
mm-hmm.
and he came onto the set with a candle that had been waxed onto the top of his head, singing happy birthday.
That's great. And Terry Stamp, just the other night at the British Film Institute, was actually reaffirming my memories, because some of the stories I tell, I'm beginning to think I've made them up. I probably have, actually. But he actually did say, you know, when we started Superman, he had been, I think, I want to say 15 to 17 years, he had been in India, and he'd been in an ashram, and his name was Swami Bami Up the Khyber something, one of those names. And he said this the other night, and he said, you know, he arrived on the set and he was still wearing his orange robes. He always wore orange of some sort. And I remember him having handmade shoes, and I can remember thinking, God, you know, here he is, this very peace-loving man. But he always used to, just at the start of every take with me, he would, this man, and for those of you that don't know, was the most gorgeous man on earth. I mean, he was the most beautiful man in the 60s and 70s, and he dined and bedded and loved some of the most beautiful women that exist, and that's a well-known fact. And he would start to tell me stories about them just before a take. So he would say, and you know Julie Christie, and I'd go, yeah? He said, well, Julie Christie, there was one night that she, and they'd go, action, and I'd go, oh! All the time. He was wonderful, and I have to say, Gene Hackman was, I just adored, was just a regular, wonderful guy. I mean, really, really, really lovely. And we just all had such a good time, didn't we? It was like one big, happy old family.
I used to, I'd go to work, and we'd have like a time when they had to change the set, or it took hours to set up some of these shots. And I would go to tramp while they were doing it.
Oh, and to dance.
That was a place everybody went to dance. And it was a nightclub. And I would go there while they were setting up the next shot.
Yes, it's that long.
And have champagne and dance my little heart off. And
the rest.
And that's how I spent a lot of Superman, was actually at tramp.
I believe it was like 90 days before the first flying shot was accepted. I mean, we had day after day after day where I did, where we didn't get onto the set, you know, endless time. So madam here was out at tramp, and I was being a good girl stuck in my dressing room. I mean, that's just, but I mean, it was endless. It really was. I mean, it was, as I said, for me, altogether was 17 months, you know, 9 months and 8 months, with a nice big break in the middle. And I remember one of the things, I don't know whether this is true or not, but I think I'm right, that Margot in the...
Cut her hair.
She cut her hair and she had her teeth done. She had the back teeth done.
And she cut bangs.
Yeah, so she came back looking completely different to match, because she was so cross about Donna, you know, being replaced, that she came back. But my story is that she'd had some back teeth, had to have them taken out, she'd had trouble. So she had a much thinner jawline, much more of a jawline or a sucked in look. So there is, if you look carefully, you can see all sorts of differences. And I know that there's lots of Superman fans that know all the differences. God help us.
They are. Yeah, go on.
We were filming part of it in Canada, and I forgot which story I was going to tell.
Never mind.
$3,000 a day. Yes. Thank you.
I know them all.
He knows mine as well.
The man who picked out where you shoot something, the location man, had picked this area in in Canada that it was the rainy season, and we were shooting all exterior shots. So every day to keep
the morale,
and also the insurance company happy, we had to get up, get dressed, go to the set, and sit and wait for these huge torrential downpours to stop. And as a joke, I had made up t-shirts that said on the back, or on the front, another day, and on the back, another $200,000.
Yes, that's a
picture.
And with a picture of me on it. And that day that I handed out the t-shirt was the day that all the bigwigs from come to the set to see why we were
costing so much money. good luck.
Oops.
Next, yeah. You've already beat me. There, you're in the sunglasses.
It was between 40 and 60 feet. I mean, we were a long way up. You know, it was the Bond stage, which in those days was the largest stage in the world. I don't think it is now. So it was, you were very high up. But once you were up. I mean, that was it. And there you hung, because it took way too long to bring in he wouldn't bring in a stepladder, but I mean, it was way too long to bring you down and do stuff. So you literally were hanging around. And the other thing is, you know, if you fly with your cameras there, when you're flying, if I flew straight on and you were the camera, you wouldn't see my face. So you always have to fly at an angle. So the actual business of just having two wires on your hips, you had to fly squiffy. Well, sorry, it's an English word. Somebody said to me, "What's squiffy?" the other day, and I said, "But you had to fly at an angle so that your face could be seen." And I was told, by the end of the movie, I was only allowed to fly 20 minutes on the wires and an hour off with a nurse on the set, because my back was so screwed up with different injuries, but my spine and everything had started to shift over to one side, and they had medical people there all the time. But it was a serious issue. I mean, this was all uncharted territory, this flying business. You know, as I said, Peter Pan had a big harness. You know, us guys got up there and just flew. You know, so it's taken its toll on me anyway. I mean, to this day. And I know Jack O'Halloran I saw on Sunday, and he's just had his hips redone and his back, and he's got problems, and it's undoubtedly from those days. But we live to tell the tale, which is the main thing.
Next question.
Go on, she's going to have to, that young lady's going to have to say something. That Feyora girl, I need
to
know.
All right, let's hear something from you. You got to have something.
Yeah, give me something about this character, which you've all been very tactful not to ask me about.
Come on.
I'm talking to the young
Feyora,
lady dressed as Feyora, because maybe I'm wrong, but that's what that is, isn't it? Yeah?
Come on.
Go on.
Don't be shy.
Yeah. That's great. I think we've got a different, I think that we have a completely different character here. Everybody keeps saying, what's it like? And I said, you know, there isn't a comparison. Not because I think mine's any better, but I just think that they're two completely, completely different characters. And I'm sorry that she has short black hair, if you know what I mean. I'm sorry that we've gone down looking a little bit like. But just to wave my own flag, I have to say that I think the villains in our organza and nothing else were, if not more powerful, were certainly as powerful as Man of Steel's villains, with all of their armor and all of this stuff that they wear. And I know it's, you know, 30 years on and everything, but there's something rather marvelous about the fact that we were three guys in, you know, long boots and organza, and it worked. Uh-huh. And again, I didn't feel like it was even Zod. I didn't feel like I was comparing. I thought he did a bloody good job as a different sort of a villain. I think it's a shame that they've tried. And Jack said to me, he said, they couldn't find anybody to play me. So he said, I said, I wonder why that is.
But it's very strange because I'm having, and I completely understand why everybody says, what's it like? Well, it was 30 years ago, you know? I mean, I thought the young lady who I believe is German, she wasn't English, that's for sure. Yeah, we think she's German because we checked her out last night because I said she's got a slight accent. I thought, for her, she did the very best with not a lot of dialogue or not so many good lines. But the outfit, the whole look is completely different. You know, one of the things that Terry Stout did, and I'm a real fidget, and I move and I do, and one of the wonderful things about Superman that I look at now and I think, bloody hell, Sarah, not bad, because Terrence was the one that said, we have nothing to show that we're villains, to show that we're from outer space, we're aliens. Whereas your Man of Steel guys, you know, it's pretty obvious they're the aliens, isn't it, because of the way they look. He said, we have nothing to show for it. We have only the way we move. And we have to be slightly different from the regulars, from the Valeries and, well, sorry, Miss Teschmachers and the characters in the movie. So he said to me, let us walk in unison. Let us practice walking so that we walk together and we flow. And I don't know that any of you would necessarily notice, but we actually worked on walking as one. So there's just something slightly different, which you might not catch, but subliminally, we're not crashing around and I'm not fidgeting, which is brilliant, you know, I'm still. So that is a very, very valid fact, that the fact that the villains, you know, we're from out, you knew we were aliens. And I mean, it wasn't just because of the way we were dressed. You know, we were slightly different, but you didn't quite know what it was. And that, to me, says something about the difference between the two roles. But good outfit, well done. Okay.
You, sir.
Can you say a quote from one of the movies, Ask Ursa?
What do you mean? There you are. No, it's just, let's just hold hands. That's what they all want.
That's it, it's over.
How about you?
Yeah, for both of you, really. Do you guys have any current projects you're working on that you can share with us?
I'm retired. The shakes have kind of put me off the map. So I'm writing a book, and oh boy.
Yeah. I tell you something, she was telling me some of the stories last night and I was going, that's going to be one hot book, so you should all look for it. The title alone is pretty, the title is?
Everything They Said, I Did.
Yeah.
I did.
How about you, sir?
Uh-huh. Thank you, sir. The worst?
Yeah.
There's quite a lot of them.
there's a few, you know. The thing of it is, it's all relative, isn't it? I mean, the best one, the one that I loved the most, was The People That Time Forgot. But you could consider that was the worst one because they were all cardboard dinosaurs. Do you know what I mean? So it's all relative. I certainly, you know, I know exactly when I do Return of the Living Dead part 524, or whatever it was, that this was not going to be an epic. But quite honestly, I had to pay the mortgage and I love to work, you know? And if people want me to go and do, I mean, I did the most ghastly film in England about 2 or 3 years ago, called Strippers versus Werewolves, which I genuinely, I don't work in England, you know, I'm in Los Angeles, and it was the first film I'd done there since Superman, and on the first day I thought, what am I doing? I had a good time doing it, I had fun doing it, but it was a nightmare scenario, and there were lots of problems afterwards, and consequently the director got let go, etc. And I shouldn't have got involved, but I got involved because I wanted to play an old tart, and I've never done that. Have you ever played an old tart?
Since I got old.
Yeah. that's enough of that.
All right, we have time for maybe one more question.
Oh, well,
okay. That's the guy right in front.
Yeah.
Your entire career, what is it you cherish most?
Lenny.
Yeah. And that's okay. Really, yeah. Wasn't that Oscar nominated?
Oscar nominated.
Oscar nominated.
She won everything besides the Oscar.
The English Academy.
BAFTA.
Yes, I know BAFTA. No, it's fantastic. I embrace finally Ursa. You know, I've spent 20 years not saying, but he doesn't look like me, and it doesn't sound like me, and it doesn't act like me. And I finally thought, you know what, it is part of who I am. You know, there isn't a really, especially in the States, not so much in England, but in the States, daily somebody somewhere, especially when I'm parking the car and I'm being mean, you know, and people go, oh, you're the girl from Superman, because I'm going, will you get out of my space, whatever it is, or mouthing off to somebody, or even taking, just being tough, I guess. It's taken me a long time to accept, but there's something really, really, really exciting about being in an iconic movie and being here 30 years later where we're still all talking about it. Most of you weren't even bloody born when we started doing it, right? I wish I had done a Lenny, I tell you. I long for that kind of a role, but you know, who knows? Something might come around. But thank you all for the questions. Really appreciate your time. Thank you.